Friends, welcome to our July holiday St. David's service stream. We're really glad that you've joined us in viewing this today. Thank you for joining us. Psalm 1 says this: "Blessed is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord, who meditates on his law day and night. He's like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields fruit in season, whose leaf doesn't wither. Whatever they do, they prosper." Joining us today is an opportunity for us all to put our roots more deeply into the Word of God, that we may grow and bear fruit. We're going to start our stream today by celebrating our Kids Church channel. We really thank God for the two teams of leaders, St. Tom's and St. David's, who have worked hard in this last term to bring fun and the Lord to our families at home. I hope you've had an opportunity to view the episodes yourself. They're great fun. Please thank God for our leaders as we watch this audio visual to celebrate our Kids Church channel. Please watch with me.
Hello, I'm Liv.
My name's Jack.
Hello and welcome back.
Hello, I didn't see you there.
Hi, I'm Lily the Lollipop Lady.
Hi, fitness fiends, it's the Workout Warrior.
Hi, I'm Allie.
Hi, guys.
Hi, I'm Ned.
Hi, I'm Sam.
I'm Will.
Hi, I'm Ruben.
Hello, everyone. I'm Barbara from the Stomp Team.
Hi, guys. It's Painter Holly here.
What's going on, guys? My name's Geordie Fung.
I'm Blake Fung.
I'm Harry Fung.
And together, we're the Fung Guys.
I'm Liv, and this is Jack, but you probably already know this because we've been doing this for a while now.
And if you're watching from home, this is the Kids Church channel.
The name of Jesus, every name should bow down. Found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Come on. Therefore God exalted to the highest place,
the
given
word?
The name above every name.
Oh, okay.
So at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow down. Heaven and on earth and under the earth. Philippians chapter 2, 8 and 9. Jesus, he's the King.
He's the what?
Philippians chapter 2, 8 and 9. Jesus, he's the King. Found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient. Jesus, he's the King.
He's the what?
Philippians chapter 2, 8 and 9. Jesus, he's the King.
Oh, he's the King? Yeah, I know that. It's in the Word of God.
Given the name above every name, so at the name of Jesus, every should bow down. In heaven and on earth and under the earth.
Philippians
chapter 2, 8 and 9. Jesus, he's the King.
Philippians
chapter 2, 8 and 9. Jesus, he's the King.
Thank you.
Friends, I'm really glad to welcome this morning Michael Kwon. Michael and his family are part of our evening congregation. Michael is a GP in his work and has worked many years with AFES at Sydney University. And I wanted to introduce him to you. Michael, we're really glad that you've come. I think a couple of days ago it was your birthday.
Yep.
Happy birthday for then. I hope you had a nice dinner with your family. Michael, tell us how the COVID season has been for you and your family.
Hasn't been too bad, actually. I think one of the things is I've kept working, Sharon's kept working. Our kids have coped well when it was isolation and they were doing the distance education thing. So it hasn't been too bad at all, actually.
Can you tell us something that you've enjoyed about COVID? And can you tell us something that you've found really hard?
Family time's been great. Not ferrying around the kids all over the place, that's been fantastic. Hard? Yeah, I guess miss seeing people, actually. Church has been difficult because of the lack of social interaction, actually.
Yeah. By day, you're a GP, doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Quite a number of us, and even in our church family, in the COVID season, it's increased stress and anxiety and even making us, you know, irritable, all those sorts of things. With your GP hat on, do you have any advice on what might help us move forward out of that kind of fog?
It's interesting, isn't it? I mean, even people with anxiety and depression, one of the most important things is physical activity and social interaction. And those are the things that's been robbed from us in this whole COVID time. So, you know, it's really important to keep up our physical activity. It gets the endorphins going. It just makes us glad and happy. But also about social interaction as well. I think it's actually wrong for the government to call it social distancing. I think it's physical distancing, but we actually need to get that social connectedness keep on going.
In this COVID time, how have you kept your heart for the Lord going? What's encouraged you?
Yeah, reading the Bible. I think one of the things I've really enjoyed about online church is pairing back church to the essentials and reading the scriptures and meditating on that and praying. That's been fantastic.
Now, in this holiday stream, you're taking us into wisdom from Ezekiel.
All 48 chapters, yep.
As in the next few weeks, what are you really wanting us to learn about hope from these talks?
Yeah. I think my hope is actually to understand that if you really want to know hope, it's to know God. That's it.
Good answer. Good answer. Jared is going to help us get into Ezekiel, and Jared's going to bring the first Bible reading to us. Thanks, Jared.
Hi, I'm Jared. I attend the 10 a.m. service. Our Bible reading today comes from Ezekiel chapter 8. We'll be reading verses 1 to 18. In the sixth year, in the sixth month, on the fifth day, while I was sitting in my house and the elders of Judah were sitting before me, the hand of the sovereign Lord came upon me there. I looked and I saw a figure like that of a man. From what appeared to be his waist down, he was like fire. And from there up, his appearance was as bright as glowing metal. He stretched out what looked like a hand and took me by the hair of my head. The Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven, and in visions of God he took me to Jerusalem, to the entrance to the north gate of the inner court, where the idol that provokes to jealousy stood. And there before me was the glory of the God of Israel, as in the vision I had seen in the plain. Then he said to me, Son of man, look toward the north. So I looked, and in the entrance north of the gate of the altar I saw this idol of jealousy. And he said to me, Son of man, do you see what they are doing? The utterly detestable things the house of Israel is doing here, things that will drive me far from my sanctuary. But you will see things that are even more detestable. Then he brought me to the entrance to the court. I looked, and I saw a hole in the wall. He said to me, Son of man, now dig into the wall. So I dug into the wall and saw a doorway there. And he said to me, Go in and see the wicked and detestable things they are doing here. So I went in and looked, and I saw portrayed over all the walls all kinds of crawling things and detestable animals and all the idols of the house of Israel. In front of them stood 70 elders of the house of Israel, and Jezaniah, son of Shaphan, was standing among them. He had a censer in his hand, and a fragrant cloud of incense was rising. He said to me, "Son of man, have you seen what the elders of the house of Israel are doing in the darkness, each at the shrine of his own idol? They say, 'The Lord does not see us. The Lord has forsaken the land.'" Again he said, "You will see them doing things that are even more detestable." Then he brought me to the entrance to the north gate of the house of the Lord, and I saw women sitting there, mourning for Tammuz. He said to me, "Do you see this, son of man? You will see things that are even more detestable than this." He then brought me into the inner court of the house of the Lord, and there at the entrance to the temple, between the portico and the altar, were about 25 men. With their backs toward the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, they were bowing down to the sun in the east. He said to me, "Have you seen this, son of man? Is it a trivial matter for the house of Judah to do the detestable things they are doing here? Must they also fill the land with violence and continually provoke me to anger? Look at them putting the branch to their nose. Therefore, I will deal with them in anger. I will not look on them with pity or spare them. Although they shout in my ears, I will not listen to them."
As Gavin said, over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be going through the 48 chapters of Ezekiel. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we pray that as you speak to us, we would take what you say to heart and heed the warnings. For your Son's sake and in the power of the Spirit. Amen. As we study any part of the Bible, it's really important to read it in context. And we need to see Ezekiel in its context. And the context of Ezekiel is from a long, long time ago in a place far, far away. We know something about the rise and fall of nations. Powerful nations don't last forever. And it's the same in all generations. Even in our own lifetimes, we've seen the rise and fall of nations. It was said that the sun never set on the British Empire, and we know that that's not the case anymore. After the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, the Soviet bloc declined. The US is not as powerful and as influential as it once was. And whether we like it or not, China is rising militarily and economically. Empires rise, empires fall. The same sort of thing happened in the ancient world. Have a look at the map there. Because we read the Bible, we think that Israel is the center of everything. But have a look at the map. The powerful nations were to the east and to the west of Israel. They took it in turns to be the great empires. To the east, you've got Egypt, Greece, and Rome. To the west, you've got Assyria, Babylon, Persia. And these great nations, they traded with each other. Now, in their trade, they wouldn't go straight across through the desert. That would be silly. So what you would do is you'd go round the Fertile Crescent and you go down the coast. That's the thing that you would do. Which actually makes Israel nothing more than a trade route. And whoever controlled Israel controlled trade, and so everyone fought over it. Have a look at the timeline. After our series finished with Abraham, we know that the superpower then was Egypt. They went by the wayside, and Israel had their time in the sun. And a couple of hundred years before what happened in Ezekiel, Assyria came around and demolished the northern part of Israel. That happened in 722 BC. You see it at the top of the arm up there. I guess living in the comforts of Judah's capital in Jerusalem, you didn't worry about it too much. You know, it's like if Indonesia grew up in power and started invading Australia and they came all the way down and invaded Queensland, I mean, we wouldn't be worried. What's a few Queenslanders amongst friends? Who cares? They wouldn't even open up the border during the COVID crisis. But now Assyria, the international bully of the 8th century, has met her match. there's a new nation more powerful than Assyria. Babylon ended up conquering Assyria and defeating her. Now, you might think that's a bit of relief. Your enemy is destroyed. But Babylon only turned out to be the replacement of one bully for another. Eventually, in 597 BC, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon and his army invaded Judah and laid siege to the capital, Jerusalem. And about 588 BC, the inhabitants of Jerusalem were sent to Babylon. It's like the new enemy now doesn't stop at Queensland. They've come through the forest, down all the way to Macquarie Street. And now there's a revolutionary guard on every street corner. They're just about to rip you out of your home and send you far, far away outside Australia. Well, what you have in front of you now is the timeline of Ezekiel. This is what we're going to be doing over the next few weeks. What it has is the book of Ezekiel, its major sections, the dates, the chapters, and the key events. What we're going to do this week is chapters 1 to 24, next week, 25 to 32, and chapters 33 to 39 in the third week, and we're going to finish with Ezekiel's final vision in 40 to 48. Well, that's the background. And you might ask, why do you want to go back there? Why do you want to look at this obscure book, Ezekiel, and what are we going to learn there? This is the time in the Old Testament that's known as the exile, the darkest day of the Old Testament. The people themselves has lost hope. What are we going to learn from them? And what's worse, we're going to learn that all this happened as a result of God's judgment. It's not just some random event, random rise and fall in geopolitical power or something like that. What we learn is behind Babylon's army is actually the will of God. They were his instruments. And when you know that God is against you, what hope can there be? But friends, that's our story as well, isn't it? We know that God is against you. We know that God is against us. When the righteousness of God is revealed, when his wrath is poured out against us, what hope is there? What hope is there when we stand under the judgment of God? Darkness actually shows up our faulty thinking sometimes, doesn't it? You learn what doesn't work. You learn that you can't just go through it and hoping for the best. You can't just close your eyes and say, well, what I can't see can't hurt me. You can't just ignore it. You know, it's like if you've got cancer, you just can't take jelly beans. What's going to be clear is that it's precisely against this dark background, when we see it in all its hopelessness, it will be there that true hope, biblical hope, hope that's got God in there, it's there that true hope will be found. Now, it's in this context that Ezekiel was called. So please turn with me in your Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 1. The book opens actually 5 or so years after Nebuchadnezzar's army took the first group of exiles from Jerusalem to Babylon. Scholars tell us it's an anniversary coming up. The date was the 28th of July, 593 BC. That's in verse 2. On the fifth day of the month, it was the fifth year of the exile of King Jehoiachin. That's the date. That's the time. And in verse 1, it says, in the 30th year, in the fourth month, on the fifth day of the month, as I was among the exiles by the Kibar Canal. The commentators tell us that that was Ezekiel's 30th year. And the 30th year was like our 18th year or 21st birthday. It's a significant year. My daughter Anastasia just turned 18 a couple of weeks ago, a significant milestone. She's now old enough to vote, old enough to skip juvie and go straight to adult jail. The 30th year was when trainee priests took on the temple service. And so this trainee, who's from a priestly family, having done his theological training at the University of Jerusalem or whatever, finds himself without a job. He's in exile. The temple is gone. Exile far from the Jerusalem temple, the very symbol of God's presence, far from his home in a pagan land by a sewage canal in Babylon. What happened? In verse 1, the heavens were opened and I saw visions of God. Ezekiel tries to describe what he sees and he's blown away. And if you read it, there's just an incredible vision. And lots of people have written lots and lots and lots about it. But it's interesting to note what Ezekiel himself says he saw. You'll see that in verse 28. He sums up what he sees. Such was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. Ezekiel sees the glory of the Lord, the God of the Israelites. He might dwell in Jerusalem, but he is everywhere. He rules everywhere, even to Ezekiel in exile, far, far away. But why? Why did God appear to Ezekiel? Well, Ezekiel was to be a prophet, to speak God's word. Have a look in the next chapter, chapter 2, verse 4. I will send you to them, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord God. Have a look at verse 5. And whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they will know that a prophet has been among them. Verse 7. And you shall speak my words to them, whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house. Ezekiel's task was to speak God's word. When he speaks, God speaks. For the time being, it doesn't matter what he says, we don't need to know that. But the prophet is to go to the people of Israel to announce that God's word has come. God speaks. We know something about the messenger, but what about the people? We learn about the recipients already, haven't we? They're people who won't listen. We learn they're stubborn and rebellious in verses 3 and 5. It's like that old saying, there is none so blind as those who will not see. It's worse than blindness itself. The God of the universe speaks, and Israel won't listen. Of course, it's always the problem, isn't it, of the person who's in rebellion against God. They don't want to know what God says. And you may preach to them, and in fact, Ezekiel, you must preach to them. But you don't expect them to listen or to do anything about it. They will not listen. And because of this, God makes his prophet hardened. That's what his name means. It's an awful ministry, isn't it, that he's being called to. You must speak. You will speak a message that the people won't listen to you because they don't want to listen to me. But don't worry, I'm going to make you tough so that you can preach to them, even though they hate you. Well, what's the conclusion? It's actually back in the previous chapter, in verse 5, chapter 2, verse 5. They'll conclude that there's going to be a prophet among them. And whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they will know that a prophet has been among them. Whether Israel likes it or not, whether they listen or fail to listen, whether they hear or refuse to hear, whether our world likes it or not, whether our world listens or refuses to listen, God speaks and they will know it. And Ezekiel was sent for that purpose. Now, if you're rebellious Israel, that's terrifying. You can say, well, life might go on in Babylon. We can make the best out of a bad lot. And you can generate a circum-optimism. You can look forward to returning home. Perhaps things will be better. But that can only happen if you keep God out of the picture. And God has sent Ezekiel to make that impossible. Ezekiel will speak God's word. And whether they like it or not, they will know that God has spoken. Well, what does God say? We'll find out after the prayers and after the second Bible reading.
Hi, everyone. I'm Lucy, and I usually go to the 5:15 service, but I've also been doing a bit of online 10 a.m. service, so I guess you could say at the moment I'm a bit of both. Today I'm going to be praying and thanking God for our kids' church ministry, which we just saw a snippet of. I'll also be thanking God for our youth team, and then I'll be praying for those who are suffering in our church community and then our wider global community. And lastly, I'll be praying and thanking God for the book of Ezekiel and asking him to help us to be able to learn from it in the weeks to come. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you desire even the youngest of children to know and love you. We thank you that you say, let the little children come, for the kingdom of God belongs to one such as these. Father, we then thank you for the efforts of the Kids Church team and Kids Church Channel, for Rach, Liv, Jack and Ali, and for all the other leaders who have been a part of this online ministry. Thank you that it has been an opportunity for families to engage with your word together, and it has encouraged these kids to think about your gospel and the book of Acts. We pray for the kids ministry now as we figure out what it's going to look like in the upcoming terms. Help us as a church to be champions for teaching our kids your word. Help us to be teachers of your gospel and to never give up on kids ministry. Lord, we also thank you for the work that's been done by the youth team. We are especially thankful for Nick and for this legacy he's created for online youth group. And Lord, we pray that more and more kids will be coming in term three as we are eventually going back to being live and relaunching youth. And lastly, Lord, we're thankful that this has been an opportunity for us to connect with our Link ministries and missionaries from across the globe. And we pray that as restrictions ease and life starts going offline again, we will not forget about these missionaries and the work that they're doing for your gospel. We now ask, Lord, that you be with our church community in the midst of our suffering and pain. We especially pray for Elaine. Thank you that she has enjoyed to be part of our online church community. And we pray that you will provide her swift medical attention and that she will become well enough to be able to return home. Lord, we pray for Elaine and those in our church community who are experiencing suffering. Please show them how loved they are by you, God. Have your hand over these families and people. And as we pray the words of 1 Corinthians 2, acknowledging that you are the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our troubles and distress and makes us ready for your salvation. We also lament, Lord, at the state of the world. We pray that hearts will turn to you in this pandemic. We pray that amongst the chaos and the death and the pain and the injustice, your glory will be a light to those who are suffering. We know that your patience is salvation, but we still eagerly pray, Lord Jesus, come. We know that ultimately true justice and true restoration is in you alone, Lord. Help us then in the meantime to be prepared for your return, to be zealously championing your name, to freely give up the riches and comforts of what we have now in Forestville and beyond, so that we don't fall into the ways of this world and that we can eagerly spread your gospel. And lastly, Lord, we pray for the book of Ezekiel. As we come to learn from this book over the course of the next few weeks, open our eyes and hearts to be rebuked, encouraged, and to learn more about your character, Lord. As we dwell on what true hope is in a hopeless world, we pray that you alone will satisfy us. Teach us to never grow complacent with the message of your judgment, but to see only your sovereignty and only your power. There is no salvation in what we do. There is no salvation in our work, our hobbies, our families, our religious actions. Help us to dwell then and be thankful that this salvation is a gift that we cannot and do not deserve. As we think about true hope, let us be wholly satisfied with you, Lord. I end this prayer with echoing the words of Ezekiel. Remove our hearts of stone and give us hearts of flesh, so that we may beat only for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, I'm Michelle from the evening service, and I'm doing today's reading from Romans 1, 18 to 32. The wrath of God is being revealed from the heavens against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them because God made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity, for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped the served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. Furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a deprived mind to do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are selfless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them.
Well, God calls Ezekiel in exile to speak his word to a rebellious people. And whether they like it or not, they will hear it. Well, what does he actually say? Chapters 4 to 24 takes us through the 7 years or so following Ezekiel's call in 593 BC. These chapters, 4 to 24, are a summary of the 7 years of preaching, and I'm going to do a summary of the summary. If you have the outline sent in the church email, it's a little bit more extensive, but what I'm going to do is just pick a few so that you get the feel of it. Turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 5, the next couple of chapters. Ezekiel chapter 5, verse 13. Thus shall my anger spend itself, and I will vent my fury upon them and satisfy myself, and they shall know that I am the Lord. Next chapter, verse 7. And the slain shall fall in your midst, and you shall know that I am the Lord. Go down a couple of verses, verse 10. And they shall know that I'm the Lord. I have not said in vain that I would do this evil to them. Another few verses, verse 14. And I will stretch out my hand against them and make the land desolate and waste in all their dwelling places from the wilderness to Riblah. Then they will know that I'm the Lord. Next chapter, chapter 7, verse 4. And my eye will not spare you, nor will I have pity, but I will punish you for your ways. While your abominations are in your midst, then you will know that I am the Lord. Chapter 11, verse 12. I will judge you at the border of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. For you have not walked in my statutes, nor obeyed my rules, but have acted according to the rules of the nations round about you. A couple of chapters on. Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 14. And I will break down the wall that you have smeared with whitewash and bring it down to the ground so that at its foundations will be laid bare. When it falls, you shall perish in the midst of it. And you shall know that I am the Lord. Have a look right at the end of the section, Ezekiel chapter 23, verse 49. And they shall return to your lewdness upon you, and you shall bear the penalty for your sinful idolatry, and you shall know that I am the Lord God. What's the message? God's judgment is coming. God will be God, and you will know it. It's a message that shatters optimism. You really can't say, hey, it's not the end of the world. After all, we still have our religion. We still have our practices and traditions. We still got Jerusalem, that still stands. The temple, that's still there. Someday we'll go back there. We might start again. It could be far worse. And through these 7 years, from chapters 4 to 24, in a crazy number of ways, God says through Ezekiel, it is far worse. God is against you. His judgment comes, and there is one certain fact that lies in your future. God will be God, and you will know it. Through these chapters, Ezekiel performs symbolic acts that make the point. He preaches powerful sermons that make the point. He tells elaborate parables that make the point, again and again and again. And in chapters 8 to 11, he tells us of an incredible vision, an incredible experience that makes the point. Turn back with me to chapter 8. That was our first reading. Chapter 8, verse 1. In the sixth year, in the sixth month, on the fifth day of the month, as I sat in my house with the elders of Judah sitting before me, the hand of the Lord fell upon me there. Then I looked, and behold, a form that had the appearance of a man. Below what appeared to be his waist was fire, and above this waist was something like the appearance of brightness, like gleaming metal. He put out the form of a hand and took me by the lock of my head, and the Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven and brought me in visions of God to Jerusalem, to the entrance of the gateway of the inner court that faces north, where there was the seat of the image of jealousy, which provokes to jealousy. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, like the vision that I saw in the valley. Now, I don't know what exactly his experience was, but in some sense or another, Ezekiel was brought back to Jerusalem, to the north gate of the inner court of the temple. And Ezekiel is given a vision of what the activities inside that temple look like to God, what God thinks of them. And weirdly, you can see there, on the one hand in verse 3, he sees the idol or the image of jealousy, which provokes to jealousy. And on the other hand, in verse 4, he saw the glory of God of Israel, as he has seen it back in Babylon 14 months earlier in chapter 1. He sees, in other words, a total contradiction. The reality of God in one hand, and then the idolatry of Israel. Now, the glory of God in Jerusalem's temple, that's understandable. That was the place that God says, my name will dwell there. That was the place that his glory would dwell. But Ezekiel saw something else as well. Come down with me to verse 5 in chapter 8. Then he said to me, son of man, lift up your eyes now towards the north. So I lifted my eyes towards the north, and behold, north of the altar gate in the entrance was the image of jealousy. And he said to me, son of man, do you see what they're doing? The great abominations that the house of Israel are committing here to drive me far from my sanctuary. But you will still see greater abominations. And the chapter goes on. Don't know what exactly was going on in the temple, but you can see what it looked like to God, an abomination. It probably is religious activities. Have a look in verse 11. Each had his censer in his hand, and the smoke of the cloud of incense went up. Then he said to me, son of man, have you seen what the elders of the house of Israel are doing in the dark, each in his own room of pictures? For they say, the Lord does not see us. The Lord has forsaken the land. Incense, smells, images. Some sort of religion was going on in the Jerusalem temple. Not, mind you, the humble hearing of God's word. That wasn't going on in Jerusalem temple. Not the rigorous repentance of sin. That wasn't going on in the Jerusalem temple. Not a cry to God for much needed forgiveness and mercy. No, but some sort of religious practice, that was going on. It gives us a sense of confidence, doesn't it? A bit of stability. And there's more. Down in verse 15, have you seen this, O son of man? You will still see greater abominations than these. But the reality of God shatters sham optimism. Have a look at verse 18. Therefore, I will act in wrath. My eye will not spare, nor will I have pity. And though they cry in my ears with a loud voice, I will not hear them. Sometimes religious practices and religion can take place of the reality of knowing God. I can remember when I first became a Christian, I would say to myself, hey, if only I read the Bible, I'd have a better day. The day would go well for me. It was almost like a magic charm for me. I remember getting caught up with singing and music and beautiful Christian songs and being so caught up that I forgot what I was singing about. Music, quiet times, they're all beautiful things. They're good things. But sometimes, when they're done wrong, it actually doesn't take God's word seriously. It misses the reality and turns him into a nothing. We need to turn to him for forgiveness and being transformed by that forgiveness. We need the reality of knowing that we need his mercy and depend on our body and soul on his mercy. How easily we can have religious practices, but not reality. Although they shout in my ears, I will not hear them. And the consequences are terrible. You'll see them in chapters 9 and 10. In chapters 9, you see the punishment that's coming on his people. See, for example, verse 10 of chapter 9. As for me, my eye will not spare, nor will I have pity. I will bring their deeds upon their heads. We've already seen that. But chapter 10 is a really horrific part of Ezekiel. The glory of God, the very presence of God, departs from the Jerusalem temple. Step by step, stage by stage, God abandons his people. He gives them over to their sin. And you see it again in chapter 11 in the first 13 verses. Same sort of thing. And I will bring you out of the midst of it and give you into the hands of foreigners and execute judgments upon you. You shall fall by the sword. I will judge you at the border of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. It could hardly be clearer, could it? God is against them. And when God is against you, what hope can there be? The answer of that to that question, you just get an indication, just an inkling of it in the end of chapter 11. An answer, the only possible answer actually, which is a bit of a paradox. If God is against you, then the only possible hope that there can be is God. That's what we're going to be looking at in a couple of weeks' time. Well, chapter 11 finishes with Ezekiel brought back to the visions in Babylon, where he told the exile everything that he'd seen. Now, for 7 years, Ezekiel brought that message of hopelessness in various ways to the exiles in Babylon, until at last, in chapter 24, this phase of his ministry reached its tragic climax. Turn with me finally to chapter 24 of Ezekiel. I'm reading from verse 15. The word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, I'm about to take the delight of your eyes away from you at a stroke. Yet you shall not mourn or weep, nor shall your tears run down. Sigh, but not aloud. Make no mourning for the dead. Bind on your turban and put your shoes on your feet. Do not cover your lips, nor eat the bread of men. So I spoke to the people in the morning, and at evening, my wife died. And on the next morning, I did as I commanded. And so Ezekiel becomes in his own person a picture of utter hopelessness and despair. Such hopelessness that he couldn't even cry. Such despair that he could do nothing but to groan in silence. And so unnatural was it that the people came to him and asked him, what are you saying by this behavior? And Ezekiel said to them, he was assigned to them. They're going to do what he was doing. They're going to become what he had become, because God was about to destroy the center of their lives. God was about to destroy Jerusalem and the temple. They're about to be smashed to nothing. And so in verse 24 of chapter 24, thus shall Ezekiel be to you a sign. According to all that he has done, you shall do. When this comes, then you will know that I am the Lord God. You'll see next week, that's just exactly what's happened. Well, it's a great series on hope, isn't it? I actually think it is. If to know God is to know hope, real hope, then to know God is also to know the hopelessness of centering our motivating our life on anything else. Jelly beans and cancer and all that. And we should know that more clearly and sharply and starkly than even Israel did in the exile. In the exile, in the events recorded for us in the book of Ezekiel, God's wrath was revealed. In Romans 1, we know that there's no hope for a world under God's wrath. There's no hope in this world for a person under God's wrath. What will fix it isn't religious practices. It isn't optimism. It isn't wishful thinking. It took Jesus who took on God's wrath on our behalf. There is only one place to look for hope if God is against you, and that is to God.
Invites me to call him Father. Only
in a series on hope, there's our first peg in the ground. Apart from God, there is no hope. Hope is found in God alone. The New Testament sharpens that for us, doesn't it? Apart from God, there is no hope. Hope is found in Christ alone. As we allow that talk to challenge us and provoke us to honour our God, let me pray. You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. You are worthy, Lamb of God, for you were slain, and with your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe, language, people, and nation, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, be praise and honour and glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Sometimes it's good to pause when we hear a strong word. Let me bring to you a couple of different announcements. The first one is an invitation for those of you who are watching our St. David's July stream but have never been to St. David's. We'd love to hear from you. When re-entry comes, we'd love to meet you. We'd love you to let us know that you're watching. Email us, office@stdavids.com.au. I'm sure you'll find our website. Leave us a message. We'd love to make contact and give you some more information about what life is like outside of COVID times. The second thing that I wanted to say was our virtual morning tea is being manned by Scott this morning after our service. Please come and join him so we can have a conversation about hope and hopelessness and the hope that we can only find in God alone. Please join us for virtual morning tea. And third, if you're a member of St. David's, in the last few days, hopefully you received some communication from staff and wardens about re-entry plans. We're trying to work towards having face-to-face services in our other congregations on the 26th of July when third term starts. We're trying to fit in the COVID regulations, which means that we need to make various decisions. Please read the communication. Please pray for the parish council and the staff. And please join us as we work towards re-entry and meeting again face-to-face. It's a great excitement and there's some work to do. We'd love you to join us for that. And we'd love you to let us know of your questions or concerns or things that you need to know. Marina can help you in the office get some of those answers, or the wardens or the staff. Please speak to someone if you have questions about our plan. Well, we're going to finish our July service stream with a song that invites us to praise God. God's holiness challenges us, but in Jesus, we're invited to praise God as the one in whom we have a safe place. Let's sing of him.
darling, it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy.
Blessed is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord. God's word today has reminded us, apart from God, there is no hope. Our hope is found in Christ alone. Thank you for joining us today. Have a great and safe holiday period. I'd recommend that you went to Queensland and not Victoria, but you be careful with your choices. Let me finish with a prayer. Father, take us and use us to love and serve all people in the power of your Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you for coming.